Okay, I have 7 o'clock. Are we ready back there for the video? All right. So with that, I'm going to call the meeting to order. This is the council, regular council meeting for February 1st, 2015. And welcome everyone that's here this evening and also for those that may be watching later on in YouTube. Our first order of business is I would like to ask that one, first of all, please turn off all your electronic devices. And or mute them or put them on airplane mode. And then would you please join me in the Pledge of Allegiance?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
So with that, I'll make some introductions. To my right, our staff is our administrator, Mike Barone, finance director, Brian Grimm, community development director, David Abel, our attorney with Kennedy and Graven, Ron Batty, and coming to his seat is our chief of police, Paul Falls. We also have another attorney with us this evening, Doug Schaftel, and over then I'm Mayor Lisa Whalen, and to my left is council members Patricia Thoele, Mark Vanderlinde, Pam Mortenson, Bob Christians, and on the end we have our engineer, Paul Hornby with WSB, and then our city clerk, Kris, and I think that does it for everybody. So with that, again, welcome, and first I need approval of the agenda. Are there any additions or changes? Hearing none, then is there a motion to approve the agenda as presented? I'll do that under.
Got it. I'll make a motion to approve the agenda as presented.
Okay, is there a second?
I'll second that.
Okay, motion has been made and seconded by Ms. Mortenson to approve the agenda as presented. All those in favor signify with aye.
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed, motion passes. So if we have two special presentations this evening, and I'd like to start out with a special presentation for Margaret Davis. I'm going to ask Margaret to come forward, and I'm going to come forward as well. This is a special recognition for Margaret Davis, who served on the Park Commission, previously also a council member. I had the pleasure of serving with Margaret for 8 years. So, with this, I just would like to read the recognition, Margaret. This is commending Margaret Davis for her service on the City of Minnetrista's Park Commission. And Margaret Davis served as a valuable and dedicated member of the Parks Commission from 2010 through 2015. Margaret was elected in 2000 to serve on the City Council from 2001 through 2004 and was re-elected to serve a second term on the Council from 2005 through 2008. Margaret served as the city's representative on the Lake Minnetonka Cable Commission, the LMCC, from 2004 through 2009. So during part of that time, she was on the council, but she also served as a citizen representative as well. Margaret provided leadership and dedication in the beautification program with the city, and Margaret helped forge the future of Minnetrista through her active participation in the city's parks, trails, and open spaces plan. And Margaret worked with our park commissioners to take care of the city's environment and natural resources by participating in the development of the Dakota Rail Trail. Now, therefore, be it resolved by the City Council of the City of Minnetrista that Margaret Davis be commended and thanked for her dedication and years of public service, most recently with her 6 years on the Parks Commission.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Can I have a resolution, a motion for that?
I'll make the motion.
Okay, is there a second?
Second.
Okay, there's a motion and a second to commend Margaret Davis for her years of service on the Park Commission. And all those in favor signify with aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. All those opposed, motion passes. So we have a certificate for you, Margaret, and then we have a little plaque for you. It's not much, but it's a plaque.
It's beautiful.
And we appreciate all your time and service to the city, and I'm sure you'll be around again.
Absolutely. I want to thank you, Mayor Whalen. I also want to note for the record that we have a great council and lots to look forward to, and I've been keeping track of the paper. And I have been here and I've gone through four administrators and seen council come and go, ideas change.
So next we have Ms. Pam Myers with us from the West Tonka Historical Society. Welcome and thank you for coming.
Thank you, Mayor Whalen, City Council members. I appreciate the time this evening. I actually have a volunteer here who's going to do the little update for you tonight. Good that we could make a connection to get on the agenda. Appreciate that. My two cents is to say we just had to reprint this book. Some of you will remember that we printed it most recently for the Minnetrista sesquicentennial in 2008, and we were out of print. We sold all the ones that we printed then, and so we just reprinted, so we have a new supply.
Good.
That's good.
That's wonderful.
At the history of Minnetrista.
That's great.
Liz Vandam is here, and she'll do the update for you.
Thank you.
Again.
Oh, and Ms. Myers, where can one get this book?
Oh, good. The one I have in my hand is for sale.
Okay.
The museum is open from 10 to 2 every Saturday, and our gift shop has many books about local history, including this one.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, folks. I'm Liz Vandam, and I live in Mound, and I volunteer with the West Tonka Historical Society as a treasurer, newsletter contributor. I manage the Facebook page and the Twitter account, and I also look out for the membership list. And if you've ever been on a nonprofit with a nonprofit group, there are many, many hats. I also get the mail. If you don't know, our mission is to preserve and to share the history of Minnetrista, Mound, Spring Park, Orono, and Minnetonka Beach. We're located in the Centennial Building, used to be the City Hall. Okay, so we're still right across the street from the new City Hall. And this evening, you'll see in front of you that I have offered a list of our history talks that will be coming up for the rest of this first part of the year. So it should go through spring. Our current newsletter and an updated brochure. I hope you will take a few minutes whenever it's convenient and just take a look at them. They're pretty fun. We really get a kick out of putting the newsletter together, and the brochure is another one of my little jobs. I just updated that, and it was really fun to do. And just to piggyback on Mayor Whalen asking where she can get these books, something new that you'll see when we come back and visit you in our next newsletter is that we now have a gift shop on our website. We have another wonderful volunteer who's doing great stuff on the website. So when you're not doing anything, just take a look and see what we've done on there. We've got lots and lots of books, as well as a way to update your membership if you like online, and also donate if you'd like to as well. Do you have any questions for me?
We don't, but thank you so much. Any
you bet.
Questions? Yeah. Thank you very much.
Thanks for
you have to be sure and visit your website. All right. So next we'll move on to persons to be heard, and we don't have anybody signed up. So we have our consent agenda items. I would like to remove consent agenda item D from the consent and do that immediately following. So that would leave us with A, approve our regular meeting minutes from January 19th, approve our closed session meeting minutes from January 19th, and approve our claims. Number D, we're moving, and number E would be a resolution adopting our 2016 city standard specifications and detail plates. And F would be approve a resolution of support recommending continuation of the CDBG funding of Western Communities Action Network. And G is approve plans and specifications, authorize advertisements for bid for municipal production wells 6 and 7. And H is approve purchase of a Ford F-550 cab and chases for public works. And I is approve the scope of services for the 2040 update of the comprehensive plan. J is approve the professional services for the water supply plan update. And K is approve payment of temporary easement agreement for water main project, city project 02-15. Any questions? Otherwise, a motion to approve consent agenda A, B, C, E, F, G, H, I, J, and K.
So moved.
Is there a second?
I'll second that.
Okay, is there any further discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor signify with aye. Aye.
Aye.
Okay, all those opposed, motion passes 5-0. So next we're approving the appointments for the Parks Commission, and I just wanted to draw that out because we're excited to have a full Parks Commission again. We did the interviews in our work session. There were two applicants. So one was not able to make it. The other one, Mr. James Nelson, was able to make it. And I think both applicants will be a very nice addition to our Parks Commission. And we're looking forward to having you on board. And we just want to say thank you so much for your service. And thank you for doing this. We know it takes time out of your busy schedules. And we really appreciate it when our citizens step forward and participate in local city government. So with that, we have two people to approve to the Parks Commission, and that would be Mr. James Nelson and also Mr. Jeff Reiser for 3-year terms. Is there a motion?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second it.
Okay, motion has been made and seconded to approve Mr. James Nelson and Mr. Jeff Reiser to our Parks Commission. Any further questions, comments? All those in favor signify with aye.
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed, motion passes, and thank you. So we don't have any public hearings this evening, so we'll move on to our business items. And this is approved professional services for the feasibility study and report for Halstead Drive improvements. I believe that would be Mr. Hornby. We've been talking about improving and servicing Halstead Drive for a while, so this is exciting.
Yes, good evening, Mayor and members of the council. In your packet is a memorandum by me and a proposal from WSB and Associates to prepare the feasibility report for the Halstead Drive improvements, and that would be from Highland Road to County Road 110 West. The capital improvement plan shows that project is a budget of $4.5 million. It's slated for a 2017 project, and in order to have that project in construction in 2017, we will need to start the preliminary design in 2016. So we wanted to get the feasibility report in front of you for consideration. The proposal for the services includes the, turn the page here, includes preliminary design, feasibility report preparation, geotechnical report, so we go out and take soil borings and get preliminary soil report, topographic survey. With a topographic survey, the portion where the water main go for the 2016 water mains and water system improvements, we'll utilize that survey data, but we may have to supplement that out on the very edges for roadway touchdown, you know, when you at the right-of-way line. There may not be enough data out there to get that. And then also it'd be a full survey from Farm Hill going to the west. And then there's also a wetland delineation. The total amount of the proposal is $72,059. If this is a project the council is not sure would go forward, we could consider taking the field work out of it and do the preliminary report based on mapping of information that's already available, such as LIDAR contours. It would help reduce that cost down to about $46,000.
Okay, explain that again, Mr. Hornby.
Sometimes if, you know, if you're not sure that this project would go forward through the public process, generally in the preliminary design, when you're going through the 429 process, if you get a lot of resistance from landowners to potential assessments or for other funding reasons, we do what I call a paper feasibility report. So we'd use existing mapping that we have and contours that we have from LIDAR data that we get through the DNR. We have that for all of Hennepin County. Yeah, we can use that data, but there is, you know, it's not as, we can't do as detailed of a preliminary design with that. So we tend to be more conservative in our estimates to try to provide a budgetary amount for the project. So we, at some point we'll still have to do the topographic survey. We'd still have to do the soil report. And we still would have to do the wetland delineation, but we would do that as part of the final design if the project goes forward. So there's some items we could drop off of here if you would like us to do
so.
Would there be a dish, would it cost more if we went that route in the end, or would it be about the same?
My experience has been this project's gonna go forward, you're gonna spend, you're gonna get a more detailed preliminary design, which is gonna roll right into final design. I think you're actually gonna spend a little less doing it that way overall. If we do what I would call a paper feasibility report, we'll tend to be a little bit more conservative. We still have to go out and get quotes to do the field work as well. So, there's a small margin of dollars that you're gonna probably spend this a little higher.
Okay.
So I leave that up to the council, but the proposal is for $72,059. Staff does recommend adopting the resolution, authorizing the preparation of the feasibility report, topographic survey, the wetland delineation, and the preliminary design for Halstead Drive.
And then the other question I might pose, or maybe staff could answer, is currently we have some funding in our MSA fund, and we do need to start using that, otherwise we do start losing some. Is that correct?
That is correct, yes.
Okay.
So what happens is in state aid, when you hit a certain threshold, which we are at that threshold, because we have a high balance, you end up with a disincentive. Mm-hmm. So you get a reduction in your needs, which is part of what they use to allocate estimate your allocation every year. So you do have a little bit of a penalty in there, so it is reduced slightly.
And we did just hit that recently, because we had spent most of our funds, or if not all of them, on the Highland Road project several years ago.
Correct. So we've been essentially banking your MSA funds.
Right.
Now the MSA funds you don't get that reimbursement back until you get into a final design phase. Once you go through and you bid the project and award it, then you can recoup some of those design dollars, and you can recoup 8% of the eligible amount you can recoup for design.
But that wouldn't come until 2017?
That wouldn't come until you award the project. So you can't take some of that to pay for the feasibility report now, unfortunately.
And you're saying not all of it would be covered by MSA funds either?
No, I think your maximum on state aid once you get through construction is 25% is what you can, 25% of the participating amount for design, design, right of way, and so forth. Just for the design portion of it,
mm-hmm.
You can recover all of your eligible costs through state aid. We have about $1.3 million in the account now, and the project budget, and I can't tell you how that's been derived, was right now it's $4.5 million.
Okay.
So obviously there's a funding gap there between what's budgeted and what we have in our state aid account.
Right, and we would have to finance
or
float a bond for it. Mm-hmm. Did you do something like that for Highland Road as well?
Correct. Yeah, we still had a portion that we bonded. It was I'm trying to think. Yeah, I mean, we had 1.3 we applied from the state aid, but then we still had another. I think we bonded for another closer to $1 million or something for it.
And then some of that was paid for by St. Bonnie as well.
Correct. Yeah, I was actually taking that into account. But yeah, I think we floated a bond for $1.5 million. But I think part of that was for Highland Road. Part of it was from some other utility projects we did. So, mm-hmm. But we didn't have enough to pay. Just straight,
right,
just cash for it. So,
okay. So, council, what is your pleasure? Any other questions for staff?
I appreciate Mr. Hornby offering that other scenario as a way to potentially save some money or delay spending money. It would seem to me that at this moment in time, we've committed to doing that project in 2017, so it would seem that the smart decision would be to not spend any money, even if it's a small amount that's not necessary. So
you're saying the difference?
Just to do the
full thing,
do the full plan, right out of the box.
Anybody else? Pam? Bob?
I have one question. You know, you talked about, what's the worst case scenario? In other words, you mentioned some hurdles that we may have to cross with possible homeowners, property owners along the road, different kind of hurdles. What's the worst case scenario that you would run across? That could delay it or be a problem?
One of the things that councils always run into, and you're the policymakers, but the worst case that I see as an engineer is that you end up with a situation that we had here with the water system improvements. We have a whole neighborhood come in and enforce and say, we don't want this project. And you have to decide on whether you want to go forward with the project or not. You know, whether there's assessments or there's not assessments or how you want to fund that. But that's part of the public process. And, you know, that I know for, as a council member, I know I can see where that'd be very difficult to try to make a decision based on what those residents might say. So for you, I think that's probably the one of the worst things that could occur. I don't know if there's any opposition to this project. I don't know if there's, we won't know that, I suppose, until we have our public information meeting and our public hearing. So.
Well, I understand Patricia's concern and you know, spending money now, but that's why my question is, what's the worst case scenario? I mean, if we have a...
What I can tell you is, from an engineering standpoint, it's always better to have more information so we can make a better judgment to help you make a decision on the project. So the more detailed information we have, the better we can narrow down the cost of the project and give you a better budget. If we do something like taking that field work out of it, you know, we're making some assumptions, and you know, you're probably driving through the project and taking a look at it on the ground more than doing a survey, and you're making some assumptions in the report that might affect, you know, our assumptions are more conservative price-wise. So we're trying to set a budget for you that you can work with in that manner, but the more detail we have, the more we can narrow that down. That's
and there's some overlap between that and the water treatment. We've got some overlap in this.
Yes, so Shardale and Hendrickson, they did a survey out there. We're gonna utilize that survey information, I already have it, but we'll have to pick up kind of the perimeter of the right-of-way in survey, so that is included in the topographic survey estimates that WSB has prepared, and also a full survey from Farm Hill Circles going to the west, you know, so where the water main went to the east from that intersection at Halstead and Farm Hill going west all the way to Highland, that all be virgin survey.
I have a question to maybe staff regarding legal. So if we plan on doing a 429, and let's just say worst case scenario, as Mr. Hornby pointed out, all of the residents or majority of the residents come forward and say, we don't want this project. Legally, can the city can still move forward with it then?
Sure, Madam Mayor. Yes, in order to sell 429 debt, you have to assess at least 20% of the cost of the project. But you can approve a project and approve assessments even if people are opposed to it. You simply run the risk that they will appeal their assessments and mm-hmm. cause delay and expense and so forth. But
okay,
it's your decision.
So what if there's something with, if people petition the city, then there has to be a certain amount of...
Yes.
Okay.
Whenever you do a 429 project, there are two public hearings. One is the improvement hearing, which where the question is, should we build it? And after you've built it, then you have the assessment hearing where you levy the assessments. Unless there is a qualifying petition at that improvement hearing, it takes a 4/5 vote of the council to approve a project. If you get a qualifying petition, okay. then you mm-hmm. can approve it by a simple majority.
Okay, and that's what I was getting at, so.
Well, here's where I'm coming from. I'm thinking, if I lived on that road, mm-hmm. one of the questions I would have is, one, how long will it be shut down, or how long will the road be not usable? Two, is there gonna be additional cost or easements to me? And three, from a timing standpoint, and I'm not saying, I'm not disagreeing with you, I'm just throwing out worst case scenarios, because that was one of the things that I would have. Does it make any sense to maybe do a little bit of a survey or a little follow up with the homeowners that are along the road to get any kind of an input before we go forward? I mean, I would think, I mean, I'm sure we all think it would be great. I mean, you'd want improvement next to your property, but
well,
you got any thoughts on that, Mark?
Brian, I think when we did Kings Point Road, we had to put like a 5-year plan out there, right? What was that? What was that again?
I don't think that was, I think that was on Highland Road. We had to do the 5-year CIP plan, and the reason was that wasn't under Chapter 429. It was under like 475,
right?
Because I think the logistics of the project was it wasn't going to make sense to assess more than 20% because there were so few homeowners along the project. So, I mean, obviously, and maybe Paul or Ron could correct me if I'm wrong. I think there's a need on Halsted. It's, you know, been in our plan for a while. We've had several residents, I think, say, when are you going to do Halsted, you know, et cetera. Maybe not all of them, and maybe that's to Bob's point as far as, you know, how much support is there. But I think once we got the feasibility report, that's probably when we'd have some more public meetings or work sessions or type of things to figure out, you know, is it feasible to move forward as far as finances, every public support, and all those type of things, I guess, or...
That's actually correct, and then in that process, too, is where we take a look at where are the areas that we think we may need more easement or more right-of-way. So that's identified, costs are identified. We would likely bring a draft of the feasibility report to the council probably in a work session just to have some discussion about what the costs are coming out to be and how we want to fund that. You know, do we want to use a bond? Do you want to assess? Do you want to use state aid? Maybe the answer is all of the above. But want to have that discussion with the council more in a work session format so that you have that ability to make some of those decisions before it comes to as a final report.
Well, and then to Mark's point, would we have to do a 429 or can we do other kind of bonding? Because if we find out that 20% is too much, it's too high in a dollar amount for each property, then we're kind of stuck if we do 429.
Well, Madam Mayor, that's correct. I mean, you can't sell 429 debt. The rule in Minnesota is that you have to have a referendum for bonds unless you can find an exception. 429 debt is for special assessments is an exception only if you levy at least 20% of the cost. And Brian's right, there were so few property owners on Highland that we couldn't make that test. So we found an alternative form of financing through a capital improvement bond, which also doesn't affirmatively require a referendum, but it's subject to what's called a reverse referendum. So you approve it after you adopt a 5-year plan, and then people have a period of time, I think it's 30 days, in which to file a petition challenging it, which did not occur in that case. So that's an alternative to explore, which would allow you another form of financing which did not involve assessments of at least 20% and would not require an affirmative referendum, although you're subject to the reverse referendum.
And what about a GO bond? Would that not work?
Well, those are GO bonds.
Oh, okay.
It's just a GO capital improvement bond.
GO.
So, yeah, because I think with Highland Road, we knew pretty quick once we came back with the feasibility and ran some of those numbers, it's like these assessments weren't going to fly. And even with Game Farm Road before that, a couple years earlier, I mean, we had multiple meetings to try to find the right balance between what was, I guess, taxpayer, city at large, you know, the city's share of the project versus what was the right assessment to do to be able to fund the project. So I envision this would be the same way. Once we have some of those numbers for the feasibility report, we'll be able see, you know, the properties along the route and see what the initial assessment would look like and obviously put that into, you know, realistic numbers as far as whether 429 or 475 makes the most sense.
And then the other thing is, since you mentioned Game Farm Road, if you recall, I don't know if you were here or not. No, I don't think you were. But so what happened is they designed it to MSA standards and found out that the standards were so enormous and it actually was going to cost the city more, and so we did it not with non-MSA funding because it actually cost us less. And that, I don't know how Highland Road will shake out, if that's going to be the same situation, but because of the curves, and it was because of the curves and the standards MSA requires you to do, that we weren't able to meet those standards, with huge impacts to residents on those curved areas. So is that something, how would that work? Would you design it to MSA standards, and then what if the impacts are just so enormous that...
Well, we can look at some situations. I mean, right now, especially on some of those 90-degree curves out there, we have a very limited right-of-way, and we have some homes that are closer to the road and some that are farther out. Or we have some other restraint, like wetlands, that we would have to cross. It's probably more likely that we would look at applying for a variance.
Good luck with that.
Rather than going forward. And you do that through state aid. It occurs often.
When we tried that with Game Farm Road, and
they got denied.
We were denied.
I know that was a few years ago, and MnDOT has changed some of their ways in how they do that. So, it was one of those. I don't know what the circumstances was with Game Farm, but we would try to meet that. I think what I would mention to the council is, once we have the costs identified, I generally would have costs identified before I even write the report. So we can talk about what those costs would be, and then I can go back and review those areas to see what that might amount to. Are we going to run into a lot of right-of-way costs? Mm-hmm. Are we not going to do that?
Okay.
What's the opportunity for a variance? In some of the other state aid roads that I've designed, I've even had some where on the vertical, vertical curves too, where I've reduced speed limit in those areas to meet the design criteria, mm-hmm. and for different approaches for one reason or another, and have had no issue with that. I haven't had to officially apply for a variance, but we'd have to look at that in the design phase to see what we can do.
Okay. I mean, I'm assuming we're going to run into an issue. I mean, if you're talking over $4 million, there's roughly
There's 50, including Farm Hill, because Farm Hill is going to benefit from it, just similar to what we have at Game Farm.
Right.
You've got sub streets, but you're at about 50.
Right, so we're going to bump up against that assessment. Yeah. I think we're going to run into an issue there.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And actually, when last time we did a Highland, there was a lot of opposition because I think we had stuck Halstead in with Kings Point about the next 5 years we were going to be doing that. And we heard a lot from a lot of people on Halstead, which I was really surprised, was they didn't want it. And it was kind of like, serious. I mean, there was a lot of people that came forward and said no. So that's why I'm kind of leaning to spend the $43,000, let's test the waters, and then if we go forward, then do the rest of it.
Yeah, you would think that the residents would be all excited about it, but I'd feel a lot better if I knew they were.
Yeah. Well, and now the kicker is now we've lost a good share of that property along there to the watershed district, and I'm sure we're not going to.
I wouldn't say lost, though. I mean, that actually, we could probably get more right of way easily.
Right,
I think there'll be more.
I don't think we can assess them.
Yeah.
Oh, we can.
Oh, yeah. We can assess them. Yeah.
If
they're benefited.
Yeah.
Okay. Mm-hmm. So it hasn't really changed that.
Yeah.
Just the owner.
I don't know. I just feel better if I knew they were excited about it. I hate to see this ram somebody down somebody's throat.
Right. Sure. I would rather test the waters and find out first before we spend everything.
Okay.
I think Bob brings up a good point, just for all of us to remember, though, that we had a road committee in place for 3 years or whatever it was that worked with the Public's Works Department and identified those roads that were priorities and all that sort of, and this was one of them.
Sure.
So this isn't just a random road that, hey, let's do Halstead this year. And so a lot of planning has gone into this before that. My question is, because we have so many roads, and we're not widening the road, right?
May have to widen it because of the standards, and that's what we need to look at.
So what you do is we look at the traffic volume.
Mm-hmm.
So what happens is the traffic volume determines the width.
Okay.
It determines your width of the lanes and your shoulders, if you're in the rural area.
In your clear zone.
The curb.
Okay, and how much of it is already blacktop, or is gravel and is going to be going to blacktop, or we're looking at
the whole thing again, because even the blacktop portion today is probably substandard.
Yeah.
In width.
Okay.
So I think I would agree we should maybe start out with the lesser amount and then kind of test the waters and make sure that we have the majority of the people on board. I've heard from people that are like, well, when are you going to pave it? When are you going to pave it? So I think there might be both.
Is there any way to test the waters a little bit before we do anything? I mean,
well, if you wanted to do this, we could, and this is why I wanted to bring this up to the council early, is we could set a public information meeting here at City Hall,
mm-hmm.
and have it on a Wednesday night or a Tuesday night or a night that doesn't conflict with another meeting. Just invite the people who would be affected by it here, and this
mm-hmm.
would just be for discussion purposes,
yeah.
and you can get a feel for it.
And I'm fine with that. I think that's a good approach, and I want to make sure that we do that sooner than later, because I don't want the project design and all of that to go out so far that we're not in that good bidding climate frame, because there's a window of opportunity, if you will, for a good bidding climate. So if we can do it soon, that'd be great.
I like that. I just like Serenity Hills. We had that open house kind of at Serenity Hills. That was
yeah,
really productive.
Yeah, worked really good.
It was good.
So that's something we can set up here at City Hall, and we can do that.
Well,
I should I was at a conference last week, and one of the things that came up is there's a speaker there from MnDOT, and he had mentioned that they'd like to get that bidding out in January and February, because the contractors are full up for the rest of their fiscal year, which goes through the end of June for bidding. So
mm-hmm.
when you're trying to get, now you got MnDOT just looking at February is the primary month for bidding.
But maybe we could get
in
a little earlier.
As we get closer, we
yeah.
look for that window to do that.
Yeah.
I bid a project here, $1 million project in another community late last fall, with the thought they could maybe start it in the fall, but gave enough time for the contractor to complete it in 1 year if they wanted to. And they elected to do that work in 2016 and not do work in 15, but it fit in their schedule. So they bid it to get that work
mm-hmm.
early
yeah.
in 2016, to have their crews start working early and get that first project going.
And knowing that they had it coming
so
in.
So it's another
too.
Way to do that.
Yeah.
If mm-hmm. if you have volatile oil pricing on the high side, that becomes a little bit more difficult to do
mm-hmm.
because nobody can get a price more than 30 days out on oil.
Okay.
So you're also talking about from the boat landing, Halstead boat landing, all the way to 110. That being
that whole segment from 110 all the way around to
okay.
Highland.
So I guess a question I would have for Paul is, does it make more sense to have the public information meeting first based on the estimate we have, or would we want to update it in more refined estimate based on the feasibility report and then have a public meeting? I guess, what would you recommend?
Well, there's two things I like to do. Is I like to have a public information meeting ahead of the final feasibility report. And the reason I'd say that is because that way I get an idea of what, you know, people who live on that road every day, what they see, what issues they see with the roadway, so they can convey that to us. I don't drive it every day, but somebody who does can convey an issue to us.
Mm-hmm.
The other thing that it would do is also give you a little bit of an idea of what kind of other issues that people might be concerned about that you could try to include in the feasibility report or in a decision
mm-hmm.
not to go forward with the feasibility report.
Okay.
So I've done it both ways. To answer Brian's question, I've done it both ways, where you just do it, have a public information meeting up front, and then council can make a decision on whether to go forward. It's really your preference on what you feel more comfortable with. It is a large project.
Yeah. I could go either way. I think maybe your approach might be the way to go. Do the public information meeting first, get a feel, talk to the residents, and then do the feasibility report.
I'm not opposed to that. I'm just thinking, if I'm a resident that lives on that street and I come to the meeting, my resistance to the project or embracing the project might be based on, well, how much is it going to cost me?
Sure, it is.
Mm-hmm.
Roughly,
yeah.
you know, you.
It's
yeah.
often
you know,
the case.
You got to be able
mm-hmm.
to give me some degree of
could we,
idea.
Could we do that at a neighborhood
it,
meeting? I mean,
it, maybe the thing
rough?
To do, and this, you know. to give you an idea of what the actual cost of the project is, I'm not familiar with where the $4.5 million came from. I think that it actually might have come from an engineer, even that was prior to the previous one. That, but I'm not sure what the origin was of it. So, what you may want to do is just have me do something with the cost, you know, with an estimate, and then have a public information meeting, and even you even have it. You know, when we have a draft feasibility report prepared, so you have something to show residents that would come in. So you can show them how wide it's going to be. You can show them kind of an outline of where it would go on paper, so people have an idea of what the impacts might be.
Is there like, a condensed or a mini feasibility report or something that's more?
You can do it like you can project a worst case scenario and say, okay, this is kind of a worst case scenario.
I can run up some rough costs, what I would call a letter feasibility report, but it's not going to have a lot of detail in it, but it can show what the requirements are and show some figures as far as what the layout of the road would be, and probably have some pretty conservative low detail costs in it, and I can do that.
Didn't we do a meeting with Enchanted Lane?
We did, yeah.
And I thought summer. It was really beneficial. Lots of input, and I thought it was it worked really well.
I think we found out what their expectations were versus what maybe the project originally was going to be and what they felt was acceptable, at least the consensus or majority of them. Of that sample, I guess, what were there is correct, yeah.
Well, it was pretty highly attended, if I remember.
It was decent, I think. Yeah.
18, 20 people? Okay. Well, let's go that route. Do a neighborhood meeting with, a mini feasibility with some idea. Of course, we're going to have to tell them it's going to have to be, we're going to have to needle the numbers down further. But I think it'll also give us an idea in terms of what we're talking about, whether it's a 429 or something else.
And one thing to keep in mind, too, I do want to keep this moving forward as,
right.
Because we, once we start getting into any wetland impacts or any floodplain impacts or those kind of things, then the timeline gets stretched out, and I don't want that to happen.
Yeah.
Just keep it in mind, that's why I wanted to get this in front of you early to start that conversation.
Well, is it feasible or possible to do the neighborhood meeting sometime in February so that...
That's what I would try to do.
Okay,
yes.
All right.
We can still have something by the end of February just to get a feel.
Yeah, and then you could bring something back then March 1st?
That's
or
right.
March, well, whatever, the first meeting in March.
The first meeting in March, we'd look at doing something like that.
Okay. So a neighborhood meeting with a, mini feasibility, is that kind of what I'm hearing? Okay.
And I probably would just, I probably won't have much for cost for that meeting. I'm probably going to have a layout for it, but I'm probably not going to have a lot of costs available for that quickly. It's going to take me some time to put some costs together, but I'll see what I can have.
Okay.
For that.
I think the main thing is, like Patricia said, how much is this going to cost me? Yeah, this is great, but how much is it going to cost me?
Mm-hmm.
And my concern would be how long is it going to take? I mean, how long would this road be closed?
I think cost is going to be...
That's going to be the biggest.
That's going to be the biggest, too, of course.
It usually is.
That usually is, yeah.
Would it make more sense to have the neighborhood meeting a little later so that we'd have a little more of a cost estimate? Are people going to be frustrated if they show up and you say, what are the costs? And they say, well, we're working on it. I don't...
Well, you can do a... Based on...
I'm just looking at a timeline and
stuff. You can do a ballpark. Can't you do a bit?
Pull a rabbit out of your hat.
I mean, seriously, you've got a number right now. You know how many residents there are. Worst case
I have
scenario.
No idea where that number came
from. Yeah,
that's what Mr. Hornby's trying to say.
That could have been the engineer prior to.
I think it was either Mark Erickson or Dave Hutt.
So in other words, the number that you're looking
at
is kind of.
So we don't know.
Guesstimates.
It could have been out of the state aid needs report where it's cost so much per mile.
Yeah.
For a certain type of roadway, and boom, here's how many miles we have, and multiply it up. That might be where the 4.5 came from. I'm assuming that's where it came from, because it's...
Right, because it's 2.4 miles long, right? And it does, if you to state aid spec, I could see 4 million. I mean, I think 4 is a little high if it's not state aid spec. I mean, I don't know, it just seems like you say, it's usually about... Little over $1 million a mile, give or take, depending on soil conditions.
Yeah, I think this one's like 2.7. And then you do have some areas where you've got some suspect soils, you know, around those high wetland areas, and probably have some soil correction.
Well, then, Paul, what would it take and what would it cost to come up with some little more, I'm not going to hold you to a penny, but a little more accurate estimates? Because I do think it's important for the residents. They're going to ask, well, what is it going to cost? Are we going to assess them $10,000 or are we going to assess them $30,000? I mean, what are we going to assess them? When could you have those figures, and how much would it cost? How much extra would it cost if we did that up front versus at the end?
Can I jump in? Would you be able to get most of those answers if you did that $43,700 preliminary design feasibility report?
I'm sorry, can you repeat that?
Would it be possible to have the information the mayor just said, suggested, for with that preliminary design cost, that $43,000? I mean, if you did that.
If we did that, we definitely would have sufficient information 60. To do that.
That's what I'm saying, because that, as Member Thoele said, that's what the people are going to want to know. What's it going to cost me, and you're going to have it.
My recommendation at the very least would be to do that portion of it.
Okay.
You know, the field work, generally we'll do the field work up front to provide more detail.
Sure.
Or if there is some, you know, if there's a potential this project may not go forward, then I'd recommend doing the bare minimum, and we can do the field work if you decide to go forward with the project.
Yeah.
We'd want to be doing that field work the second half of this year, so we can get it.
But the $46,000, that mini, if you will, feasibility report, you could do that. When would you have the neighborhood meeting then?
Well, then I would put that on a schedule, and you know, if we did what I have in here for the $46,000, you know, that's going to be a couple months out.
Okay. And then that wouldn't delay the project any if we decide to go forward?
No.
But maybe if we said, let's not do that and let's do the open house neighborhood meeting first without potentially any numbers, that may delay it a little bit. So maybe maybe that would be the route to go.
Well, it's going to give you a lot more information than having me take a whack at it in 2 weeks and bring it back to the public information.
Right. Let's get our numbers, get our ducks in a row. Yeah. Don't rush this thing. Let's get the information so what we give to the residents is closer,
right.
I think this is going to be useful information whether the project goes in 2017. Or I mean, I remember, you know, Maple Crest Drive, there were several, you know, tries at that before it finally went forward. So, I mean, it's not like this $43,000. It's going to give us good information whether whether it happens in 2017 or, you know, maybe, you know, 18, 19, right, depending on what the people's, I guess, appetite is for it. I think at some point it's going to get done, so it's going to be, you know, useful information to have.
Yeah.
So
you're not going to waste.
Anyway. The information will be good whether it's 2017 project or later even. So
So if you spend $43,712 on a preliminary design feasibility report and then save the geotechnical, the topographic, and the wetland stuff, which is $27,000 roughly, for some other time in the future after getting feedback from an open house or neighborhood meeting or whatever you want to call it, you'll be able to give some pretty accurate costs on a per property basis, I would think, to people to find out when we're doing it, if we're doing it.
What I'd recommend, if we're going to do that, keep the field work out of it, I would recommend that you set an upper limit at $46,000. The reason I do that is because in our survey, topographic survey, I do have some drafting and mapping in that part of it that I'm going to need to do with the contours.
So you're saying some of that topographic.
So some of that I have to apply toward the preliminary design.
So the cost you list there are $43,712 for the preliminary design feasibility, but you're saying
$46,000.
$46,000.
Okay. Okay.
Not to exceed.
Yeah.
So is there a motion to approve a, help me out here, Paul, a contract for services for a preliminary, if you call it, a feasibility report in the amount of $46,000 to include estimated preliminary design or?
I would say preliminary design and feasibility report preparation not to exceed $46,000.
Okay. Is there a motion to that effect?
So moved.
Is there a second?
I'll second it.
Okay, motion has been made and seconded to approve a preliminary design and feasibility report not to exceed $46,000 with WSB. All those in favors? Oh, yeah.
One item I might add, just so I have some direction going forward if you do approve that, is in looking at the terrain out there, You've got where the Musa line is.
Mm-hmm.
You've got more urban, you've got sewer through that area. I would think that you'd want curb and gutter and storm sewer through that area. And then once you get past, is it Lakeview Drive, I think you'd want to go to a rural section so it's shoulders and ditches, or is it all? Would that be a bit?
Well, one of the things that we talked about with MCWD is I think you should talk with the watershed because there may be some other means by which to face some of those, that the water that might be more water friendly or lake friendly, if you will. So maybe
leave that open.
Yeah, leave it open. Yeah. Okay. And then after that, we'll have a neighborhood meeting. Hopefully this will take just a couple months, and then we can have a neighborhood meeting sometime, let's see, in April maybe is what we're going to shoot for. Okay.
Yep.
All right. So motion has been made and seconded. And then any further discussion? Hearing none. All those in favor signify with aye.
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 All those opposed, motion passes 5-0. Okay.
Thank you.
So next we have our pre-condemnation settlement negotiations, and this will be a closed session.
Well, Madam Mayor, the council needs to make a motion to go into closed session. So
thank you.
What we're recommending is that you close the meeting on the basis of attorney-client privilege to discuss the litigation matters involving the four parcels that we've talked about previously.
Okay, is there a motion to do that, to close the, to go into closed session to discuss the condemnations?
So moved.
Okay, is there a second?
I'll second that.
Okay, motion has been made and seconded to go into closed session for the reasons as stated. All those in favor signify with aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. All those opposed, motion passes 5-0.
Aye. Aye.
Aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, motion passes.
That was it.
Now we don't have to open the other meeting again, do we?
No, you're just okay. Back in.
We're rolling.
And
okay.
We're back in regular session.
So, all right, we're back in regular session. We just ended our closed session. So next on our agenda is administrative items. We have staff reports.
Thank you, Mayor. Council, I have a few items to discuss with you tonight. First one is we had a planning commission meeting on Monday, January 25th, and we had all seven of our planning commission members there. We have two members that are...
One was absent.
That's right. One was absent. I apologize. But we had four members total that have gotten either 1 year of experience or they just started. So the thinking was is that the meeting in January, we would present some information to them on the ins and outs of being a good planning commission member, and then also getting some information from Mr. Batty on the legalities of being, what open meeting law is, what the gift ban law is, what all the other things that relate to being on either council or, in this case, a planning commission member. So that was presented to him. The one thing that I presented to them, and I will actually make this same offer to the city council members tonight, and I will distribute something here in a minute. Some of this planning stuff, this is not my bailiwick, but a lot of this stuff on land use is fairly complicated, and the League of Minnesota Cities has a course that's an online course. I don't know exactly how long it takes, but it's an online course, so you can kind of go at your own pace. And it's set up for city officials, whether they're appointed or elected. So obviously, if you want to do that, you certainly can. It's also available to city employees. It's $30 per person, and with the caveat that if you get six or more people, anybody beyond the first six, or I guess the first $180, are free. So we made this offer to the planning commission members, and they're supposed to contact David. I'm not sure how many people I did, but I think we're going to get a couple people that are going to bite and go for the training. And like I said that night, I said I was going to make this same offer to city council members. So if you're interested in taking this online course taught by LMC, it's called Land Use Series, and the first course is Land Use Basics. There's actually two courses. But if you sign up, if we get six or more to sign up, it's $180 max. So if you are interested, I'll pass around the kind of this course descriptions. I'll send that around to you now.
And Kris, I do have one for the record. So I'll send those around, and if you are interested, please let me know. And we'll try to get this together in the next week or so, and just let me know with a telephone call or an email, and we will try to sign you up, and the information will come to you on how, what your path, what your code is, and you can go in and be recorded. So that's item one. Item two is last week on Wednesday, both Mayor Whalen and I attended the Mound Fire Commission meeting. I believe Bob was out of town. One of the things that came up that night was that Mound has been approached by a number of the neighboring communities that have fire departments, and I was wondering if Mound would be interested in joining them in a proposal, grant proposal. The focus of the grant would be on looking at fire districts. The grant essentially, I think, is focusing on just the training and staffing that would have to be needed to have a fire district, and there would not be any cost. So at the meeting, Chief Peterson was asking his participating cities, including us, if we would be interested in having, giving the okay to Mound Fire, since we, you know, we pay them for fire services for half of our city, if we would be okay with them joining in on the grant opportunity. We said yes, go for it, since there's really no cost to us to do it. You know, it would be cost the grant cost is zero. So so they're going to work on that. So I, you know, we gave that approval to them. The other kind of chunk of that is, since we have a relationship with St. Bonnie Fire as well, tomorrow morning we just coincidentally have the police commission meeting, and we're going to bring that up since Mayor Weibel and Brenda Fisk will be there. We're going to talk about that. The only person really missing is their fire chief, but we're going to kind of talk about potentially creating a meeting. I think St. Bonifacius, don't want to characterize their stance on this, but I think they're kind of against the fire commission idea, fire district idea. And so we would like to have them potentially join, because, you know, that kind of is a hole in our service area, and they work with Mound quite well together anyway. So we were hoping that they might be interested in joining. Again, there would be no cost to them, but this is all just eventually could lead to a fire district, but right now it's just in the talking point, at least to kind of see how feasible it could be. So we made that agreement with Mound to say yes, we're interested in participating, and then we'll broach that subject with St. Bonnie people tomorrow. Then one final comment. You will be seeing shortly a advertisement to seek to fill two police officer positions. And as the council remembers, we passed one police officer position in the last budget. And the other thing we did is we approved a drug task force position. That's a mid-year appointment for that particular entity. We're going to start looking for two people. The timing of this, and I'll ask Chief Falls to jump in here in a second, but we can't appoint one of our current police officers to the drug task force until mid-year anyway, but we need to have that training done for the officer in time. So we can stagger the hirings. We can look for one now, and if we find two candidates, which we hope we do for police officers, we can just tell whoever number two is that you won't be starting until late summer or fall. So, but we could get, instead of doing two processes, we could hopefully get two officers now, one for now and one for later. I don't know if there's anything you wanted to add to that, Paul.
Mr. Barone, Mayor and Council, I'll just add that the hiring process obviously is fairly time-consuming for police officers, as you know, because there's a lot of additional steps that we don't have with other staff. Most importantly, the background piece, that's a very extensive piece. And then as well, to get a new hired police officer from the point when we hire them or get them in the door on their first day to the time period where they're actually out on their own is about 16 weeks, give or take a little in either direction, depending on their experience and so on and so forth. So I also see that there's a huge benefit to advertising for two positions, because I think our response numbers to this ad are going to go up considerably, right, knowing that we're looking for two at once. So certainly we're not going to, the second one wouldn't start until that July 1st mark, but we'll be pretty close to that by the time we get through the process and get someone started, and then we can stagger that training period which would work out perfectly, so.
Yeah, there's field training officer issues. You know, we can't, I believe, can't do two new hires at the same time. We'd have to stagger that, or at least have some little overlap, but not much.
Right, we can overlap them, but certainly to have their start date be the same day would be very difficult, so.
So the first one would start approximately when?
Well, we haven't even advertised it, so.
Okay. Right, I mean, as soon as possible, ideally, but, you know, if in a perfect world, it's still going to be probably a couple of months before get to the point of getting them in the door.
To find somebody, so if we get it in the newspaper this week, this is first week of February, you're looking at April, May for a start date for the first one, and we could push off. If they know they got the job, you just got to wait till the mid-year point, once he's ready to go with getting an officer ready to go to the drug task force and off, then we can get them in here. So we're just trying to minimize the advertising costs, the recruitment costs, the testing costs, the interviewing time. So little economy of scale. We know we're going to get two some time this year. Let's do them all now and just stagger the start date for the second one.
Okay.
That's all I have for staff updates.
Okay. Anybody else in staff? Police?
Mr. Barone, did you want me to give a quick update on that incident? Madam Mayor, members of council, you probably recall I sent you an email earlier this week, or I guess it was over the weekend, regarding an alleged racial incident that occurred at the West Tonka School sporting event. You've probably seen this in the news. If you haven't, I'll just kind of summarize it. It was, I guess, front page news for a day or two. Now it seems to have kind of gone away. With that said, the school district did investigate, and essentially this incident stemmed from a dodgeball tournament. There were several teams at that tournament. Allegedly, one of the teams wore, as part of their uniform, they had white bandanas, and for whatever reason, they chose to wear those white bandanas on their heads, kind of in a pointy fashion, pointing up. And so after the fact, not at the tournament, there were some complaints made to the school about the way that appeared, and that some people took offense to that. So the school did investigate, and as a result, did ultimately suspend several students. I don't know exactly how many. As I mentioned in our email, to date, we were not involved in any of that, none of it was a criminal matter, but rather more of a school discipline issue. So since the email I sent out, there's been no updates or no further involvement on our part, so we weren't involved in the first place, and we haven't been to date, other than a little bit more presence at the school in the event there was any kind of issues or fallout from that, and as it turned out, there was none. So I think the school responded quickly, and they're still looking into a couple of loose ends, but at this point, that matter has been dealt with. So I guess that's about all I have for an update.
Thank you. Any other staff reports?
I don't believe so.
Okay, thank you. Then we'll move on to council reports. We'll start with you, Mr. Christians.
The only thing I have is just to follow up here, the annual renewal for the West Tonka Community Commerce, we talked about that briefly,
yep.
Mike. Is that, did you get a hold of Karen?
Yep, well, I gave that to Kris to do, and she's handled that. So.
Okay, the only other thing I would suggest, since we're working on the website and so forth, Cassandra, if there's a way, because I think it's kind of important, if there's a way to link West Tonka Community Commerce with...
They have links, they'll
that's
have
already
links.
Taking
yeah,
a look at that.
We're going to take, absolutely take
the link.
Yep.
Because there's a lot of valuable information comes across that West Tonka Community Commerce one.
Right.
So we can link
How
it
often
ours.
Do they meet?
Pardon?
How often do they meet?
Once a month.
Once a month, okay.
Yeah.
And were you at the last one then?
Yeah, I was at the last one. The last one was held at, last one was very interesting. In fact, it was held at Our Lady of the Lakes.
Uh-huh.
And the last one presenter, or we'll call it the spotlight person, was the food shelf. West Tonka Food Shelf, and it was done very well. And the one previous to that was done just before Christmas, and the spotlight speaker for that was Dave Osmek.
Okay.
So that was interesting.
Yeah. Okay. Pam?
Spirit of the Lakes. I am attending a board meeting this week. I think it's on Wednesday. I am part of the volunteer committee now. So if anybody wants to volunteer or know anybody, please send them my way. The dates are July 15th through the 16th. They did cut it back from a three-day event to a two-day event for their reasons. Expense was probably one of the biggest ones, and just the logistics of it. The contract for our sponsorship will be coming. They redesigned the form so it's easier to follow, and the cost is the same as last year. So we should think about, I'd like to be in the parade again. I thought that was great. The booth, I think that should be something we should discuss. I don't know if it was worth our time. If it isn't, we certainly could donate it to somebody. You know, the Spirit of the Lake Board welcome that to whoever we'd like to designate it to or whatever. Let's see. Oh, Lisa and I attended the leadership conference on the 22nd and the 23rd. It was great. And I found it very beneficial, and especially with comp planning coming up, some of these ideas were wonderful. It's a lot to do with engaging citizens throughout your community and take some of those, they call them co-creators. And one thing with comp plan, getting them on the spearhead committee, and great ways to recruit them and to utilize some of their ideas and talents. So that's about it.
Mark?
I have nothing.
Okay, Patricia?
Last night, or yesterday at 4 o'clock, I attended the North Saunders Lake Homeowners Annual Meeting that was held at the St. Bonnie Bistro. They had record attendance. About 25 people showed up, and it was just really neat to be there. They asked that I give an update on you know, what we've been working on, and so I did that. And it was just really neat to see the people in one of our neighborhoods gather together, you know, having a interest in keeping their neighborhood a pleasant place to live, and have some camaraderie amongst the neighbors, and have kind of that rural feel that we like to say that Minnetrista has. And based on receiving our packet, I did not mention to any of them about the Parks Commission opportunities because it appeared that we had closed that. I did, however, mention that somewhere in the comp plan information, or that there was mention of a community visioning committee or something to that effect. And so I just mentioned that we will be starting the process, but it's not due until December of 18. But just to be keeping their eye out on the website or in the newspaper for any call for people interested that might want to participate in that process. So,
a couple things. So, I attended the Pioneer Creek Watershed Commission on Thursday, January 21st. And one of the things I'd like to ask, I found out, Pam, that the alternate does not have to fill out the information. And I confirmed that with the administrator over there. So what my suggestion is going to be is that we appoint myself as the actual commissioner and Pam as the alternate. And then, because I can't always attend because of other meetings and also just because of so many meetings that I attend, so maybe then on those days where I can't attend, Pam could. But then at least we would be covered for those meetings. We'd have somebody there. And so I asked Pam if she would be willing to do that, and she said yes. And if the council would agree, we do need a motion to appoint me as the commissioner and Pam as the alternate. We could do that tonight.
I make a motion to appoint Mayor Whalen as the commissioner and Councilmember Mortenson as the alternate for
Pioneer Sarah Creek Watershed Commission.
Second it.
Okay, thank you. Any further questions, discussion? Okay, hearing none. All those in favor signify with aye.
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed, motion passes. In the meantime, if anybody knows of anybody else that would like to serve on this commission in that capacity, I would be more than happy to relinquish my my position. So they did award, this is kind of a first kind of a foot forward for the Pioneers here. They did award a 25% match for a feasibility study for a big gully that they're looking at. So they will be contributing about $5,000 to about a $20,000 study that will determine where the best projects could take place and where they can get the biggest bang for their buck. I also attended the fire advisory meeting with Mr. Barone, as he stated. The new ladder truck is on order and should be arriving sometime September, October. And they also talked about the duty officer and how well that's been working. They also talked about a lot of things, and I won't go into a lot of hours, but a lot of detail. But it was interesting that the firefighter hours for, just you might want some information. The total hours for Minnetrista was 1,592 hours for the year. I thought it was interesting. Total calls for Minnetrista were 91. But what was interesting, and one of the things we talked about a little bit, again, not at length, and this was kind of precipitated the discussion about the fire district, Mound typically gives more mutual aid than it receives. In other words, they go out to calls for mutual aid versus other departments coming in. And it's fairly significant. So in like 2013, they had 25 mutual aid calls that they gave, but only received nine, and only had nine where they needed mutual aid. And in 2014, 21 out and four that came in. So for some of these reasons, I think a fire district would really be a good thing. But again, the study will show what will come of that. Then also David Abel and myself, we attended a meeting with the Minnehaha Creek Watershed District on the 28th of January, and they talked about the Six Mile Creek sub-watershed and kind of where they're going to be going. I have some information here, but they'll be rolling that out in a more public forum later on, and you'll hear more about that. Basically, they want to work on a collaborative approach. They wanted to find out if there's projects. This is kind of why I mentioned it regarding the Halstead reconstruction. They want to find out what projects we're doing, how they might dovetail in with some of the projects they're doing. Maybe they can make some recommendations in terms of design and so on and so forth. So it was very interesting, and we'll be hearing more about that. Tomorrow I'll be attending the Police Advisory Committee meeting. I also attended the Planning Commission meeting and had the honor of swearing in of two renewing commissioners and then two brand new commissioners. And yes, our staff did a fabulous job. I was going to commend you on your presentations, both Mr. Barone as well as Mr. Batty. Very good, very informative. I think it's a good thing, and maybe we can do that at the Planning Commission meeting, maybe not with Mr. Barone, but with staff. That would be a good thing to do. I do plan on attending the first Park Commission meeting. Again, we have two new commissioners that I would be swearing in. So I believe that will be February. We're correct. Planning on next Tuesday, mm-hmm. So I'll be attending that. And then I'll also be attending the weekend coffee. I don't know if you all got invitations, but I don't know the date, but that's coming up in the next few next. And I also attended the LMC conference on the 22nd and 23rd of January. Ms. Mortenson and I drove together, so we had, and it was a fantastic, probably one of the best conferences that I've attended. It was very, very good. We also had a meeting with Mr. Paul, with our fire chief, and talked a little bit about Trista Days. We had some ideas for that. Pam came up with a fabulous idea. I don't want to spill the beans quite yet. I want to make sure that it is actually going to happen, but it should be very, very fun and exciting. And if that happens, we'll let you know very soon. But so we're working on some fun things for Trista Day, along with all of the fun things that the police department does. So with that, I'm done.
Madam Mayor, can I ask who's going to attend the February Planning Commission meeting? I think Pam and Patricia said that they could.
Could not for February, I'll double check on March.
So what's the date on that date?
The 22nd. Yes, 22nd.
While you're doing that, One other thing, piece of business that we need to do is we don't have a lot on the next agenda, and I know a number of people are going to be absent, including the camera person, so we will not even be able to videotape it. So what I'm suggesting that we cancel the February 16th, that would be regular council meeting. It's scheduled for Tuesday the 16th, and we're having some issues with one, the camera person, and then a couple of several council people are going to be absent. So would we need a motion to cancel that?
Yes.
Unless you guys would like to come and sit?
Tuesday the 16th?
Yes. So I'm looking for a motion to cancel the regular council work session and council meeting.
Both.
Okay. For February 16th.
So moved.
Is there a second?
Let's see, I'm trying to think of President's Day is Monday, right?
Monday. That's why it was originally scheduled for Tuesday the 16th.
Okay. I'll make a motion to cancel the work
session. A motion was made. You're seconding? Okay. Then any further questions, discussion? Okay. All those in favor signify with aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. All those opposed? Motion passes. Thank you very much. So our next meeting will actually be the first one in March.
Is it 7 o'clock?
And it's the fourth Monday, right?
Yes.
I'll take March.
Okay, 16th. So the next meeting will be on...
Wait, March?
No.
March 7th.
Is that a council meeting?
The next city council meeting, March
7th. Okay. That's correct.
They're never council meetings. They're always the fourth Monday. I think it's the 27th of March.
28th.
Or 28th. Yeah, 28th of March.
March 28th.
Yeah.
Planning.
Okay. All right. So... Are we, I think we're done then.
I will make a motion to adjourn.
Is there a second?
Second.
Okay, motion has been made and seconded. All those to adjourn, all those in favor signify with aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. All those opposed, motion passes. Thank you very much. Good job, everyone.